Good morning. This is the day that the Lord has made.
We will rejoice and be glad.
Well, that was kind of raggedy. Let's try that again. This is the day that the Lord has made.
We will rejoice and be glad.
Now, we're cheating again because you're not supposed to say hallelujah till after Easter, right? But that's okay. Because we still have an Easter promise during Lent. Lent leads to Easter, right? And the promise of Easter, the resurrection of Christ, our Savior, is also for us, and that exists right now. But there is a journey called the way of the cross to get there. There is death. And that's a reality of life. It was reality for our Lord and Savior Jesus. It's reality for us. But there is a resurrection. And so we have joy in the anticipation. And so we'll sneak in an alleluia once in a while. Okay? Okay. Take a look at the front cover of your worship folder there. This is a quote from Psalm 51. Of course, we are in a penitential season of Lent. And there are what are called the penitential psalms that are especially appropriate for the Lenten season. And so here we use a quote from Psalm 51. There are other penitential psalms. And penitence has to do with repentance, has to do with having a new mind and a new heart. Today we're taking a look at this idea of a new heart. The psalmist here, David, in response to Nathan the prophet coming to him and pointing out his sin of adultery and even murder, David's heart is broken. He realizes his sin. He confesses his sin. And then he says this prayer, "Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me." I'm giving you all an invitation here this morning to pray that same prayer during this penitential season. Because the only way we can have that clean heart is as a gift from God. We do not kid ourselves thinking we can do this ourselves. God has to be the one to give us that grace, that love. So this is our prayer for this morning, create in me a clean heart. We are talking about the heart today, and I'm posing the question, do you want the good news or the bad news first? You know, when you hear somebody say, we've all heard that expression, you want the good news or the bad news? What is your immediate feeling? I just want good news. I don't want any bad news. Or how bad is it? Or how good can it be to overcome the bad that's happening here that I'm now fearing to hear this news about? We don't want to hear bad news, do we? Here's the problem. Is there actually bad news? Yeah. Is there bad news about us and about our character, about our integrity, about our morals, about our spiritual values, about, you know, the things that we would do that we fail to do, the things that we should do that we don't do? Is there bad news there? If we're honest, yes, we admit that. But there's wonderful news. There's good news. That's why Jesus came. We're going to talk about that today and having that clean heart. So welcome. Let's pray. Father in heaven, Lord, we come into your presence here this day during this penitential season. Lord, we bow before you. We confess to you our failure. We confess to you the inadequacy of our effort, the uncleanness of our hearts, the need that we have that we cannot satisfy ourselves. We fail our own standards, Lord, and especially we fail yours. That's the bad news, Lord. But today and always, help us to see the good news in Jesus Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen. We begin with our opening praise song. Please stand. Create in me. Thank you. begin our worship service in the name of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. God's people respond.
Amen.
Our affirmation of faith for today is the third article of the Apostles' Creed with the explanation. And the third article of the Creed talks about the Holy Spirit and the work of the Holy Spirit in the Holy Christian Church and how he works this work of repentance and renewal, and very appropriate for today. So let's say this together. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. What does this mean? I believe that I cannot, by my own reason or strength, believe in Jesus Christ, my Lord, or come to him. But the Holy Spirit has called me by the gospel, enlightened me with his gifts, sanctified and kept me in the true faith. In the same way, he calls, gathers, enlightens, and sanctifies the whole Christian church of earth and keeps it with Jesus Christ in one true faith. In this Christian church, he daily and richly forgives all my sins and the sins of all believers.
On the last day,
he will raise me and all the dead and give eternal life to me and all believers in Christ. This is most certainly true. Our psalm reading for today is from Psalm 119, beginning at verse 9, and we read this responsively. How can a young person stay on the path of purity? By living according to your word.
I seek you with all my heart. Do not let me stray from your commands.
I have hidden your word in my heart, that I might not sin against you.
Praise be to you, Lord. Teach me your decrees.
With my lips I recount all the laws that come from your mouth.
I rejoice in following your statutes, as one rejoices in the great riches.
I meditate on your precepts and consider your ways.
I delight in your decrees. I will not neglect your word.
Please be seated. We continue with our scripture readings appointed for today, beginning with the Old Testament, Jeremiah chapter 31, beginning at verse 31. The days are coming, declares the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the people of Israel and with the people of Judah. It will not be like a covenant I made with their ancestors when I took them by the hand to lead them out of Egypt, because they broke my covenant, though I was a husband to them, declares the Lord. This is the covenant I will make with the people of Israel after that time, declares the Lord. I will put my law in their minds and write it on their hearts. I will be their God, and they will be my people. No longer will they teach their neighbor or say to one another, "Know the Lord," because they will all know me, from the least of them to the greatest, declares the Lord. For I will forgive their wickedness and will remember their sins no more. Our next scripture reading is from the New Testament book of Hebrews, chapter 5, beginning at verse 1. Here it's talking about the high priest and how Jesus fulfills the office of the high priest for us. Every high priest is selected from among the people and is appointed to represent the people in matters related to God, to offer gifts and sacrifices for sins. He is able to deal gently those who are ignorant and are going astray, since he himself is subject to weakness. This is why he has to offer sacrifices for his own sins, as well as for the sins of the people. And no one takes this honor on himself, but he receives it when called by God, just as Aaron was. In the same way, Christ did not take on himself the glory of becoming a high priest, but God said to him, "You are my son. Today I have become your father." And he says in another place, "You are a priest forever in the order of Melchizedek." And then our gospel reading is from the Gospel of Mark, chapter 10, Jesus called to them and said, "You know that those who are regarded as rulers of the Gentiles lord it over them, and their high officials exercise authority over them. Not so with you. Instead, whoever wants to become great among you must be your servant, and whoever wants to be first must be slave of all. For even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom for many." We join together for our message song, "God is the Strength of My Heart." Of faith, we said this morning, we confess the truth. I believe I cannot by my own reason or strength believe in Jesus Christ my Lord or come to him, but the Holy Spirit has called me by the gospel. This is something outside of ourselves. Let's watch the video here. Keith Green sings another version of Psalm 51, "Created Me a Clean Heart." Let's make this our prayer. Let's pray for God's strength right now for each and every one of us, that we would have the strength to have a new heart, to have a clean heart, to have a pure heart, to have a committed heart. Let's make this a devotional time.
Spirit within me, cast me not away from thy presence, O Lord. Take not thy Holy Spirit from me. restore unto me the joy of thy salvation, and renew a right spirit within me.
Sing it together.
Create in me a clean heart,
oh God.
Oh, God,
and renew a right spirit within me.
And renew a right spirit within me. Create in me a clean heart. Oh, God,
and renew a right spirit within me.
And renew a right spirit within me. Cast me not away
from thy presence.
From thy presence, O Lord.
O Lord, take not thy Holy Spirit from me.
Take not thy Holy Spirit from me.
Restore unto me the joy of thy salvation.
Restore unto me the joy of thy salvation.
And renew a right spirit within me.
And renew a right spirit within me. Create in me a clean heart, oh God.
Sing it to Jesus.
And renew a right spirit within me.
Close your eyes and worship. Create in me a clean heart.
Create in me a clean heart. Oh, God, and renew a right spirit within me.
Cast me not away from thy presence.
Cast me not away from thy presence.
Oh, Lord, take not thy Holy Spirit.
Take not thy Holy Spirit from me. Restore unto me the
joy of thy salvation.
The joy of thy salvation.
And renew a right spirit.
And renew a right spirit within me.
To follow along with the service outline, the sermon outline printed for you in the worship folder or on the screen, as we consider the appointed scripture readings for today during this penitential season of Lent, and this idea of with all my heart based upon the appointed psalm reading for today, Psalm 119. The psalmist asks, how can a young person stay on the path of purity? He then answers, by living according to your word, I seek you with all my heart. And isn't that the desire of each and every one of us, to pursue something or someone with all of our heart, with everything we have, with total devotion and love and passion? We want to be passionate about something or someone. We want to experience love. We want to pursue purpose, don't we? We want this to be consuming in a good way, where something is so worthwhile, we're willing to go after it with everything we are, everything we have, because that gives meaning to life, doesn't it? And to pursue that which is true and good and right and eternal, that would be the highest pursuit of all, to pursue that with all my heart. That's what we're talking about today. And why seek God with all our heart? That's the question. Why invest all of that energy in going after God? Now here, I came up against a showstopper of a sort right at the very beginning of considering this question that the psalmist asked. How can a young person stay on the path of purity? And here's the showstopper. Here's the conundrum. Here's the roadblock, the speed bump, whatever imagery you want to use here. Here's the problem. Who even cares about purity anymore? Who cares? Who cares about a clean heart? There's an article written by a high school teacher, Paul Arnwell, for The Atlantic some time ago, entitled Students' Broken Moral Compasses. And he says this at the beginning of the article. There's not time to share the whole thing. A few months ago, I presented the following scenario to my junior English students. Your boyfriend or girlfriend has committed a felony during which other people were badly harmed. Should you or should you not turn him or her into the police? The class immediately erupted with commentary. It was obvious, they said, that loyalty was paramount. Not a single student said they would, quote, snitch. This is about a felony committed with injuries. And not a single student said they would snitch. They were unequivocally unconcerned about who was harmed in this hypothetical scenario. This troubled me, he says. Really? You think there's a little problem with the moral compass there with those students? Now, if you take an objective look at the culture and the society around us, you have to be honest. If you choose to be honest, you would come to the conclusion, how could it be otherwise? Do we live in a world, in a culture, in a country where things really are right and wrong, ultimately? Now, apart from institutions, right? Okay, there's a certain thing that society must do. There's a certain thing that government must do. There's a role it must play, and it's a moral role. But individually, are there expectations about a code of behavior, about that which is objectively and eternally true or untrue, eternally good or eternally bad? It's getting increasingly more difficult to discern those kinds of things because we value freedom and choice so much, don't we? That we really have problems as a culture defining stuff as good or bad anymore. This even impacts the church. For instance, there was a time when it was simply not acceptable in the secular culture even to live together outside of marriage. Now, let me ask you, does that standard exist anymore? I didn't hear you. That's not a rhetorical question. That's an actual question. There was a time in secular society when these things were called bad, and that intimate relationship was confined to the marriage relationship. That was a given standard. Do you remember the concept of what a white dress was about for a wedding? Virginity, purity. Does that matter now? Here's where we start getting uncomfortable. Even within the church, it is getting increasingly difficult for pastors to confront people who are living together outside of marriage. Who do you think you are? Are you judging me? You have no right to judge me, right? It's not about judgment. It's about what's good and pure and proper for the sake of not just the individual, but for the sake of family, for the sake of marriage, for the sake of the children, for the sake of the future. Now here, I'm going to point something out. These young people that I was talking about here from this article in The Atlantic, this is not unusual, those kinds of things. I think about the many articles or even books I've read in the not too distant past talking about this very same issue. The debates on college campuses about the lack of moral structure, teaching, compass, if you will, the lack of focus on individual character in the face of other agendas running, the narratives, and I put that in quotes, narratives that are out there. What about character? What about purity? What about a clean heart? Well, the world can and will do what it does, apart from what we say. But within the church, we had better be clear about these things, about what is okay and what is not. This is uncomfortable territory for us to deal with. So you see, there's a roadblock right at the very beginning, isn't there? The psalmist asks, how can a young person stay on the path of purity? Do we even care? Or have we just given up? Do we even want to? Now, I'm going to point something out here. The kids care. You know, this author of this article, he went on to point out that there was a very dynamic discussion among those young people. And they wanted to talk more about these things. They hadn't dealt with these issues. So they were open to this. I've talked to you about this before. Once a week, I come on in on Wednesdays, and I visit with the Nature Academy students here, with the Nature Academy that meets on this campus. And each and every one of them cares about the conversation about morality, about character, about right and wrong, both on the corporate level, whether it's governance in society, or whether it's personal behavior, codes of behavior. They all care. I'll give you a specific. The very first day I came on in, this is a while ago, to do a class, and we call it Nature's God. It's based on the Declaration of Independence. It's kind of a civics class, but it delves even deeper about personal character and belief and spiritual matters. And we begin with a devotion, and I pray with these kids. And they love it. But at the end of that very first class with those kids, I had two of them come up to me and say, Pastor, that was great. Can we talk about God some more next week? We really like that. They're hungry for this. They're hungry for adults who behave as adults, who have a compass, who have a sense of right and wrong and good and bad. And yes, it does make a difference, kids. And the kids, they will pay attention. Now, sometimes they will rebel. Anybody who's a parent knows that children don't always do or say the right thing, right? Or they fail to do what they should do. But the kids know. And why do they know? When we talk about it, Nature Academy, Nature's God. Nature's God puts a sense, a natural moral compass within each of us. Now, it's corrupted by sin, but he gives it to us. And people have an intuitive sense. This is good, this is bad. This is not okay, or this is okay. And so we are there. Our job is there as church, as Christians, as believers, as parents, to reinforce this, not to ignore it, not to wave the white flag in the face of the culture. I can't get to first base here without dealing with this purity issue. How can a young person stay on the path of purity? First of all, we have to care about having a clean heart, about having character, about having purity. But then we wind up with the ugly reality that we are impure and unclean, aren't we? So much of what we have, who we are. We bring baggage with us, don't we? Each one of us, myself included. We fall short of those standards. So you want the good news or the bad news? You've had the bad news. The good news is this. God provides what we cannot do. He gives us the person we cannot be. He gives us Jesus. He gives us the solution so that we are motivated to pursue the Lord with all of our heart. So let's walk through these points here. Number one, my heart is overjoyed in Christ's salvation. In Christ's salvation. You see, we are saved. We are saved from our unclean state, our unclean hearts. We are saved from our impurity. We are saved from our failure. We are saved from our guilt. We are saved from our past. We are saved from our weaknesses. We are saved from our sin. We are saved from judgment. Not by pulling ourselves up by our own bootstraps, but by looking at Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith and our salvation. And I'm overjoyed. You are overjoyed by that reality. We don't love God first. He loves us first through Jesus. He begins this cycle of love. And he does it through Jesus, who 2,000 years ago lived that life we cannot live, died the death that you and I deserved on the cross. We are saved from ourselves, from sin, death, and the devil, as Martin Luther would say. This is the new covenant that Jeremiah talks about in our Old Testament reading. See, the Old Covenant, the Old Testament, is not just a section of the Bible. It's about the law of God. The Old Covenant rooted in the law. What's good, what's bad. The law defines, God's law defines what is a clean heart. God's law defines what is purity. God's law defines righteousness. And God's law says that perfection is the requirement. But the Old Testament, the Old Covenant, is full of stories about God's own people. Never mind the pagans outside of Israel. But God's own people, time after time, fail. And you and I read it and we roll our eyes. Then we reflect on our own lives. We say, well, I failed too. That's the Old Covenant. And according to the Old Covenant, you get what you deserve. We each deserve hell and damnation. But we don't receive that because God, the God of law, the God of justice, the God of good and bad and right and wrong, the God of perfect righteousness, is also the God of love. He did what we cannot do. He saved us. And we're overjoyed. Here's the thing. You can't get past the roadblock to hear this good news in order to be overjoyed unless you understand there is a standard of purity. Now, here's also the news. Just because a person may reject all of this and say, no, I don't accept your narrative, Pastor Lee, about good and bad. I don't accept the narrative of the Bible. I just don't live by that. That statement does not make you immune from the consequences of going against that divine standard. It's like trying to defy the law of gravity. It's a classic story of the parent who tells a teenager, son or daughter, who wants to do something that the parent knows is wrong. And the child will say this, the teenager will say this, but all my friends are what?
Doing it.
And what is the parental response? Well, just because all your friends want to go jump off a cliff Does that make it okay and right for you to do the same thing? Right? How many of us have heard our own parents years ago say that to us? You don't reinvent the laws of gravity just because you don't like them. And you inventing your own, quote, narrative will not change that ugly reality. There is a God who does sit on his throne. He does have a standard. And he does not wreck on our shoals. We wreck on his. Again, the bad news. We have to hear that before we can hear the good news. But there is good news. And my heart is overjoyed in Christ's salvation. Secondly, my heart is overwhelmed by Christ's sacrifice. By Christ's sacrifice. Think of it. The high priest in the Old Testament would offer sacrifice on behalf of the people. Jesus, our high priest, offers a sacrifice, but the sacrifice, unlike the Old Testament high priest, the sacrifice is himself. He's the Lamb of God, the Holy Lamb of God. He's the Agnus Dei. He is the Holy One who goes to the cross for you and me. He gives himself up to his enemies. Those who mocked him when he was being crucified, Jesus prays to his Father and says, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. That's sacrificial love. That is amazing love. While we were still God's enemies, Christ died for us, Paul says. Number three, my heart is overflowing with Christ's servanthood. Christ's servanthood. The context here, Mark chapter 10, is that his disciples were arguing about who is the greatest and who would be the one in charge. They had an idea that was very different from Jesus' own purpose in coming and his own method of working. They thought, hey, this is great. We're Jesus' followers. We're his disciples. We're part of the team, and this is a great team. We're hanging out with a guy who's going around doing all these miracles and walking on water and feeding the 5,000. We're really somebody. Look at the thousands of people following us, and we want a piece of the action here. We want to be the boss too, and so let's start picking and choosing who's going to be the vice president. We know who the president is. Who's going to be the vice president of the club? Who's going to be the secretary? Who's going to be the treasurer? Who's going to get to be the sergeant at arms? Who's going to, you know, I mean, you just picture this. Now, of course, they're not talking about those specific offices, but they're talking about being in charge and bossing people and having the corner office upstairs with the windows. And Jesus is shaking his head going, you guys got it all wrong. I did not come to be served, but to serve and to give my life as the price for your freedom from sin. If you want to follow me, you better understand that's the way of the cross, not the way of glory. You got to be a servant, not a dictator. Jesus, being the Son of God himself, having the power to destroy the entire universe or create it, chooses to love rather than condemn, chooses to serve rather than dictate, even today. He doesn't force anyone to accept his narrative. If you want to reject him, you're free to do so. But he's there to serve you and me. He said, I didn't come to lord it over people. We see this when Jesus is in that upper room, John chapter 13. He washes his disciples' stinky feet. And then he says, you do the same if you want to understand what I'm about. Well, how can we not be overjoyed or overwhelmed? How can we not overflow with that kind of inspirational love. This is why we serve him with all our heart. This is why we say what we say in a culture, in a country, and even a church that increasingly seems to reject these truths. This is why we are passionate. This gives us purpose that transcends even the persecution that may follow. Because we are uplifted. We have joy. We have love. With all our hearts, let's pray. Lord, create in me a clean heart and renew a right spirit within us all. Lord, help us to receive the bad news so that we can hear the good news and be renewed and have that joy and be overwhelmed and have an overflowing sense of purpose and place in the universe. Fill our hearts, Lord, so that with all of our hearts, we can follow you. Lord, forgive us for those times when we have taken the easy way out, when we've gone the way of the world and the culture, when we've waved the white flag and given up. Forgive us, Lord. Inspire us. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Because of Jesus, I declare to you, your sins, they have been forgiven. You are clean. You are pure, not with your righteousness, but with his. And you do have purpose. And now I invite you to follow him with your whole heart. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. We continue the prayers of God's people. Father in heaven, thank you, Lord, for this beautiful day in which we can gather together as your people in this place. Lord, we pray for those who cannot be with us here this morning, those online watching. Lord, we pray that you would be with us all. Fill our hearts, Lord, with your Holy Spirit. Create in us a new spirit, a new heart, a renewed heart, a passionate heart, full of your love and place and purpose. Lord, we pray specifically for this congregation here in the call process that's going on right now. We pray, Lord, that you would prepare the man who would take this call. We pray, Lord, that you would bless this process and the outcome. We pray that this would be your man for this place and this time. Lord, we pray for the world around us, Lord. So many lost, so many searching, so many without answers. Lord, we pray especially for our children, our young people, who are hungry for the truth, who do want something and someone to believe in, someone to follow, and a place and a purpose in the universe. And an understanding of what is right and wrong, good and bad, pure and impure. Lord, help us to be mentors and models for them. But first we begin with ourselves, Lord, and a commitment to you. Help us, Lord, fill us with your spirit so we can pursue you with our whole hearts. Father, we pray for this ongoing pandemic. We thank you, Lord, for the strides being made medically with vaccines and other treatments. We pray, Lord, that this pandemic would ease and that life would go back to a more normal state. Lord, we pray specifically for certain people. We name here in our hearts, we pray, Lord, for Grace, Al, Sandy, Greg, Julie, Carolyn, Diana, Joan, State Trooper Brian Frank, Carolyn Wagner, be with all of these people, Lord. We pray for your healing, for your grace during this time of testing and trial. Lord, we pray for the Stutz family who are traveling to Florida for safety on their trip. Lord, we do continue to pray for the Biblica Project, and we pray your will be done there and your guidance there as well. Lord, and now, as we prepare to receive the Lord's Supper, we pray that you would prepare our hearts and help us to be wholehearted in believing your promise in both word and sacrament. These gifts of bread and wine, Christ's body and blood, for us, to inspire us and fill us. And now, Lord, we sum up all of our prayers in that perfect prayer Jesus has taught us, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, "Take and eat, this is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." In the same way also, he took the cup after supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Also with you.
Welcome to the Lord's table. Take and eat, take and drink. Now may this true body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ keep and preserve you steadfast and pure. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. And the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with his favor, and may he always give you his peace. Amen. Please stand for our closing song.
Sorry. Registration is now closed. We have almost 90 kids, and I had to remember how many parking spots, thanks to Bev, so that we didn't have to worry about a parking situation. So registration is closed. Our Easter egg hunt is next Sunday. If there's anybody who can stay around after the service, just to help, like, check the families in, make sure they're registered, kind of put them in the different spots that they need to be in. I did buy a megaphone, so hopefully they can hear me through that. So just trying to make it as, like, organized as possible, as this is our first year of doing something this big. There is a sign-up sheet if you'd like to sign up for that. I will probably go out there at like 11 o'clock on the dot just to make sure, but by like 11:30, hopefully everybody's kind of here. Good Friday service, again, is April 2nd at 6 p.m. It will be streamed live if you can't make it. It will be a tenebrae service, a nice meditation, so definitely try and come out for that. Since last year it had to be a recorded service, this year we'll get to actually have an in-person. Again, Voice of Care is our mission of the month for March. So if you haven't been able to make a donation yet, there is a plate back there to put your donations in there. Easter lilies, if you'd like to order one, they are due next week. They're $9, so make sure you get that into Bev. We would like to schedule a spring cleanup day, just kind of cleaning up the perennials and cleaning up the outside area. Of leaves and anything like that. So if there's a day that you think you might be available, let us know. We'd like to get a team together and kind of clean up around everywhere. We need a few volunteers today to take a couple of boxes of flooring that's in Pastor's office and put it into the garage outside. There also is a panel left over from the bathrooms that can just go into the dumpster. And there's some hardware that can go into the dumpster. They want us to pay for it to ship back, and it would be super expensive, so we don't need it, so we can just pitch it. Church Council is, of course, looking for openings again, so if you are interested, please reach out to one of us and let us know. We'd love to have you on the Church Council, and we'd love to have a nice big Church Council as we try to grow forward. We are meeting with Pastor Herb this Tuesday night. So hopefully we'll get a little more feel of what he is looking for, if he is ready to take a call, if he's ready to take our call, or everything like that. If you need readings or anything like that, they're back by Bev's office. And then our last thing is Peter Wasselkoff actually came up with an awesome idea, another great thing to help the community around us. A lot of our elderly and just in general are having a hard time finding this vaccine. So if there's people who would be willing to sit on the phone or do research to find a vaccine in the local area for people who can't seem to find a vaccine right now, we would greatly appreciate it. We want to try and help everybody who would like to become vaccinated. And we know a lot of people are still struggling to try and find an appointment. So. As we start to look more and find different areas that are opening up for vaccines, we would love to, if there's people who would be willing to make calls for others and get online. Sometimes it seems that they have to get you have to be up late at night to register or get an appointment, or up early. So if somebody is available to do that, just another great way to help out not only our church, but our community as well. I think that's all. So have a great weekend. We'll see.
If you remember Linda Tarandi, she used to come here. She had cancer for a little bit. She passed away Thursday. She was only 56. Yeah. And the wake is Tuesday. Hills, someplace. You have to look it up. I don't think they did it in Vegas. And the funeral Wednesday. I mean, her husband, her two kids, Clarissa. Dennis is the boy. Yeah. She passed away Thursday.
Oh.
Okay. She had cancer for a long time. She went through a lot.
Oh.
Yeah, maybe we can find out the information and get it emailed out too, if anybody. Okay, Bev will email out any of that information if anybody'd like to attend those services. I think that's it. Next Sunday is Palm Sunday too, so be ready for your palms. We'll see you next week. Make sure to wave to the camera.
Thank you.